We shall start to proceed to the thesis defense entitled Interaction Dynamics and Autonomy in Cognitive Systems by Miguel Aguilera. The candidate will proceed with the defense. We'll sit here, listen carefully to you, and then we'll have the interrogation. Okay?
So, present now the defense of the spatial interaction dynamics and autonomy in cognitive systems. This dissertation is focused on the idea of autonomous agency. We have chosen this topic because we find that it can be interesting in the midst of attention that we identify that is repeated through the history of science and the study of lifeline and cognition between holistic and reductionistic perspectives. And when we want to understand, for example, a living entity, we can, on the one hand, analyze the organisms or the self or the intention or other macroscopic properties, or if we want to understand how the components of the system produce this behavior, we can isolate parts of the system like molecules, cells, or neurons, or tissues, but we have the risk of, by isolating these components, losing sight of the initial macroscopic systems that we wanted to analyze. And this can happen in individual living entities, but it also can happen in collective entities, like we can analyze collectives or peoples or cultures. But if we want to take a look, a closer look, at the components like individuals or groups or institutions that compose this initial macroscopic system, we have the risk of losing track of this macroscopic level when we isolate the initial microscopic level, the other microscopic level. And we find that a notion of autonomy as a scientific account of autonomy is useful in order to assess the identity of these components that are coupled to a system but without being subsumed by it, without losing their specific identity in the interaction with this macroscopic system. And we find that this idea of autonomy is useful for depicting what Barella has called the cellular self, that is a virtual identity that has no particular application and it's not reducible to the components of the system, yet it is emerging from a material substrate in continuous interaction among the parts that compose the system and especially with the surrounding environment. And we find different concepts and different notions through the history of science that try to capture these two types of properties, the ones that try to understand the persistence of an identity of a system and the ones that try to capture the coordination or the interaction of the parts of the component, of the components of the system and these components interacting with the environment. So our objective is that an idea of autonomy can be useful to put together these two types of properties into one form of organization. And if we look back into operational definitions of autonomy that can help us to address this issue, we find that there is much work developed in the domain of biological or cellular autonomy, like notions of autopoiesis from Maturana and Barella, and more modern notions of basic autonomy in a cellular or metabolic realm, like this from Ezequiel and Moreno, in which they define a basic biological autonomy as an organization in which there is a functional and organizational integration of inner constitutive processes, with, for example, a metabolism which is able to construct a membrane that physically isolates the system from its environment, and on a second term, of regulation of this boundary or regulation of this permeable membrane by controlling the flows of matter and energy that go through the boundary, and by doing so maintaining the organization of the system. And in that sense, we can enclose the autonomy of the system to the inner mechanisms of the system and the regulation of its boundary. And this is very helpful for defining autonomy, but it's not always sufficient for what we intuitively define or consider as an autonomous agent in a higher level. And we find that on top of this basic biological autonomy, we can find that autonomy can be extended to different levels and different domains at scales that are much larger than a biological cell. So in that sense, we find that it's useful to define different levels of interactive autonomous agency to capture how autonomy can be extended into other domains that go beyond the basic autonomous organization. And we took this definition from Barandiaran et al. Of autonomous agency, which states that an autonomous agent is a system that is defined by itself as an active source of interaction according to some self-generated norms. And they describe how a system can do that not only by modulating the physical boundary that boundary of interaction between the system and the external domain, but by modulating the coupling of this system with its environment. So now we are not only modulating a physical boundary, but we are modulating the interaction itself, which becomes constitutive of this form of autonomy that expands the basic biological autonomy. And now, so autonomy may be expanded to an interactive domain on top of the organizational layers of the system at first. And we can think, for example, of a vegetative state as an example of a system in which we can have a perfectly working biological autonomy. We have cells that are self-constituted themselves, but the system is not able to be an active source of interaction in a more sensorimotor domain. It cannot be coupled to the world in that sense. And therefore, this autonomy cannot be extended to this new level. But if instead we think of another example of autonomous behavior of an agent, for example, dancing a hula hoop, we can have a system that is defined as a unit, as a dynamical unit, which is coordinating its movement with an environment, which is the hula hoop. It's an active source of interaction because even if there are other forces acting on the system, like gravity or friction or other perturbations like wind, the agent is able to coordinate its behavior in a sense that it's going to maintain a dynamical equilibrium, which is going to be according to some cellular norms, which consists in keep the hula hoop twirling around your waist. We can think of different situations in which this extended level of autonomy can be broken, can disappear. For example, the hula hoop breaks, or we cannot have access to a hula hoop, and our basic autonomous agency is still working, but this interactive domain has disappeared, and now this autonomy, which is constitutively interactive, is not there anymore. And we can think that this can happen not only when we interact with a non-autonomous environment, but also when we interact with other autonomous agents. For example, a couple dancing, we can identify a system that is a dynamical unit, which is first different from other couples dancing, and it's an active source of interaction according to some self-generated norms, which are generated not in the individual domains of the agents, but in the interaction between the two of them. And also, we can think more examples of collective autonomy, for example, in a dancing multitude, which is again able to define itself as a dynamical unit, which is an active source of interaction with some self-generated norms, which are generated in a collective domain. So we are going to, for this dissertation, we are going to distinguish between two different domains, a neurocognitive domain and a social domain. And for each one, we are going to ask two different questions. The first one is that, is there an interactive domain on top of the biological constitution of the agent which can allow the emergence of an interactive autonomous agency? And the second question is how this autonomous agency can be constructed open this interactive domain. So with this division, we are going to have four different parts, dividing between the neurocognitive and the social domain, and the interactive domain and the autonomous constitution of the agent. And we're going to use the different tools from dynamical systems and information theory and one-over scaling in order to analyze how this interactive domain and this constitution of autonomous agency takes place. So we shall start with neurocognitive autonomy. and conclude with the importance and the role of interactive domain in neurocognitive agency. And we are going to do it with a very simple system interacting with an environment, which is going to be a really clever robot. So our question is, how is a domain of interaction constitutive of a neurodynamic system, and how can we quantify what is missing in the case when this sensorimotor domain no longer exists? So for exploring this, we are going to analyze a simple running climbing agent, which is going to be controlled by two oscillatory units with an HKB model, which is a very well-known model, or a very simple model of coordination of two oscillatory units, which has been applied in different instances for analyzing neural coordination. And we're going to connect this neurodynamic model with a sensor perceiving a gradient and two motors driving the movement of the agent. And we're going to adjust the parameters to find a gradient climbing behavior, and we're going to let one free parameter, sensitivity parameter, which modulates different forms of behavior of the agent. We're going to have this cycloidal agent, which has this screw-like movement. We're going to have an agent that will be to the center of the gradient. And we're going to have this spiral movement agent, which approaches more slowly to the center of the gradient. And we can analyze the different behaviors, and we can precisely map the points of transition between one behavior and the next. So we have a precise characterization of the behavior of the agent, and we're going to use this agent to understand what's the role of this interactive domain we were talking about. So in order to assess what's the importance of not only the internal controllers of the agent, but this sensorimotor domain of interaction, we're going to compare two different types of systems. We're going to have the situated HCB system, which is the regular agent interacting with the world, and we are going to have a decoupled HKB, which is the same neural controller of the agent before. But in order to compare the two of them, we are going to feed the decoupled HKB system with the input recorded from the situated HKB. So both of the systems are receiving the exact same input, and we are going to analyze what's the difference between two systems with the same input, but one is connected, one is coordinated with the environment, is able to influence the environment, and the other one is not able to influence the environment, although the signal it receives is structured the same way. So in order to understand the difference between the two types of systems, we are going to use a dynamical systems analysis in order to solve the system. The system is not very complex, it consists only in three dimensions, three differential equations, and we can easily solve the fixed points of the system and find that the system has one attractor and one repeller for both the situated agent and the passively coupled agent. And we find that these fixed points can show us which are the points of behavioral transitions, and we have three points of transition which correspond to the initial behavioral transition of the agent. So the three eigenvalues that we extract from the situated system allow us to understand what transitions take place and what are the nature of this transition. We find the regular attractors, or we find the spiral attractors for each kind of behavior. We can explain the behavior of the agent with these attractor and repellers. But if we analyze the passively coupled agent, we find that the passively coupled agent cannot account for the transition between the different types of behavior. So in this case, we cannot understand how the system is working if we have just a passively coupled agent. Secondly, we can not only analyze the behavior of the fixed points of the agents, the attractor and the repellers, but we can analyze the behavior at the transient, of how the system behaves before or after it's in a fixed point. And we find that for the situated agents, the transients are not trivial, they have different time scales of deployment, but the passively coupled agent has just one simple unidimensional dynamics for the trees and an exponential approach. So we find that much of the richness of the dynamics of the system is only captured by the situated agent and not by the passively coupled agent. After this, we can analyze more complex situations and add fluctuations to the system. We can add a white noise input, a white noise to the input of the situated agent, and find how the situated and the passively coupled agent behave. We find that the situated agent is able to compensate these perturbations and maintain a small amount of noise in the system. However, the passive decoupled agent is not able to compensate these perturbations. The fluctuations of the system are much larger, and they are strongly correlated. So if we wanted to analyze a passively coupled agent which is not really interacting with the world, we will find that we are measuring these very large fluctuations which are not present in the initial systems. Finally, we wanted to have a better characterization of this domain of sensory-motor interaction. We describe what we call the dynamical signature of the system, which is a statistical function collapsing the phase space of the agent to one of its variables. So we took the three-dimensional phase space and collapsed it to just one of the variables, which is this file, which represents the values of the internal controller of the agent. And we represent the density function of the values of the file versus its derivative. So we can see how the environment, how the interaction of the environment shapes the behavior of this variable. We find that, for example, for this behavior, we have this structure, and we observe that this structure of the dynamical signature of the agent, it is lost when we have a passive decoupled agent. And we can see how different behaviors have different signatures, but they are all lost when we analyze the passive decoupled agent. So here we can see how, what's the importance of the coupling of the coordination with the environment for shaping the internal dynamics of the controller. Even if, again, both of the systems are receiving the same exact signal as an input. So to conclude this part, we can think that some cognitive processes, when they are connected in a sensorimotor interaction, they are constituted by brain-body environment system, by the brain-body environment system as a whole. And in that sense, we cannot reduce the cognitive process to a decoupled or a passively coupled agent operating according to some representations of the world or other detached interaction with the world. And instead, our hypothesis is that neurocognitive autonomy is constituted over the regulation of this domain of interaction. And now we shall pass to the second part of the analysis of neurocognitive agency, which addresses the autonomous constitution of an agent. For doing so, we are going to analyze a slightly more complex situation of an agent interacting with an environment, but with noise going to have some particularities. So the idea here is that for an agent to be autonomous, it needs not only to be coupled to an environment, to be engaged in an environment, but it needs to be able to actively regulate the conditions of its exchange with the environment. So it needs to be able to modulate somehow this coupling in order to assert its autonomy. So it can, the agent before, we can think that it's only present in an interaction in a sensorimotor loop, coupling with a sensorimotor linkage, but it's always trapped in the same loop. But an autonomous agent should be able to engage in one loop of interaction with the environment, disengage at some point, and perform other new form of interaction with the world. So somehow our idea here is that an autonomous agent should be able to have this kind of double regulatory loop in which the system is engaged with the environment, but it has a form of internal regulation which is able to generate some patterns that regulate the initial coupling with the world. So this loop here is going to be able to switch between different loops of sensory-motor interaction. And such a model of autonomous agents should be able to characterize properties such as intentionality or meaning or purposeful behavior, which are typically just described in a qualitative way or in a theoretical way and are hard to capture in a more formal analysis. So we want to model a scenario where we can an agent has the possibility of modulating its coupling with an environment. So we have a simple robot with three oscillators, but now we are going to have a slightly more complex environment with two different sources of stimulus, which are going to be two different lights of two different colors, and we are going to add some internal elasticity to the neural controller of the agent. And we have been inspired in previous models of homeostatic regulation of internal neurodynamics, which proposed the existence of homeostatic regions controlling the behavior of the agent. We could think that an agent has different regions of homeostasis in which the behavior of the system is stable, and whenever the state of the system goes outside these regions, the agent will trigger plastic mechanisms that start changing the configuration of the agent until it finds a new area of a new region of homeostasis. And in this way, the agent can engage and disengage from different forms of interaction with the world. And our objective here was to extend these previous models of homeostatic regulation with the idea that these regions of homeostatic behavior should not only be predefined, but the agent should be able to, in some way, generate these homeostatic regions and modulate them and change its position and in coordination with its engagement with the environment. So we can imagine an agent which is engaged by the environment in some way, and it has a homeostatic region which determines the stability of its behavior, and if at some point the behavior becomes unstable, the agent should be able to generate a new region of homeostasis which allows him to enter a new form of engagement with the world and maintain this new form of engagement with the world if it maintains some invariants or some conditions of stability. And we do so by changing the definition of homeostatic regulation in our system, and instead of defining the homeostatic regulation in terms of the individual components or the state of individual components, we add the idea of a relational homeostasis. So what is maintaining in this homeostatic system is not the state of the components, but the relation between one component and other components. So we have adjusted the parameters of the robot using an artificial evolution, and we found a robot which is able to develop stable preference to one light or the other and modulate this preference. So there's trials when the agent is going to go to one light, and then it's going to change its preference and go to other light for some trials. And we find that the agent is able to do so by changing the shape of its internal homeostatic regions of neurodynamic regulation. And for different trials, we find that we have different shapes of this homeostatic region. So we wanted to analyze to which point this agent will be modeling the behavior of an autonomous agent, and how we can measure so, and what kind of measures can give us an idea of that type of behavior. So for doing so, we have analyzed different groups of variables that control the behavior of the agent. First, we have analyzed what we have called the cell assemblies of the agent, which consist in the activities of the internal oscillators of the agent, which now are going to be three oscillators, which present different types of relations at different points. The second group of variables is what we call the synapse assemblies, which consist in the state of the connections of the synapses between the different neurodynamic oscillators. And we can see that the state of the connections is changing, and we have transitions at different velocities coordinated with the activity of the oscillators. And finally, the last variable consists in the engagement with the environment, with the engagement with the two lights that the agent is interacting with. And so we map the distance to the two lights with this variable L, and we find this behavior, which the agent is going to one light, and at some point it changes its behavior and goes to the other. So we have these three variables, and we are going to use different measures to analyze how they are interacting. So first, we are going to analyze the mutual information, which allow us to understand how much information is shared between the two variables, and then we are going to analyze the transfer entropy to understand how much information one variable transfers to another, how much one variable influences another. So first, we can analyze the mutual information, and we find. And again, we are going to compare a situated agent interacting with its world and a passively coupled agent which receives the same signal than the situated agent, but it is not in coupling with the world. And we find that if we analyze the mutual information between the different groups of variables, we find that whenever the synapses are involved, the information is much reduced and sometimes even drastically. So we find that there is a very clear difference between the two types of agents. Because even if they the different variables have the same levels of entropy, the mutual information is reduced when the agent is not coupled to the world. To have a more detailed picture, we can analyze not only the information they serve, but the information transfer. How one variable influences another, how one variable transfer information to another. And we can take groups, pairs of variables, and see how interact with each other at different temporal scales. And we find that some variables influence others at medium time scales, and other influence others in larger time scales. So we can take this map here and simplify it a little bit and find something like this, in which we find that we have arrows of fast time scales and arrows of slow time scales, and we find that for distributed agents we have this kind of circular relationship between the different variables, in which the environment influences the oscillator at fast time scales, but the synapses influence the behavior of the agent at slow time scales, and the same happens with the circular regulation between the synapses and the cell assemblies, which the state of the synapses influence at fast time scales the oscillators, and at slow time scales the opposite happens. And we see how the autonomous agency closes an asymmetrical loop of agent-environment interaction with this circular relation between the variables. But we find that for the passive decoupled agent, this loop is broken. And it's broken at two points in which the information of the transfer entropy is reduced. So we find that the agent is receiving the same information from the environment, but it is not able to close these loops of modulation. And this is what distinguishes very clearly the situated agent from the passive decoupled agent. And we can even have a more detail on the behavior of the agent, but by not only analyzing the mutual information in a static picture, but to analyze the mutual information at different moments of time. The mutual information about the behavior of an agent at the end of the trial. And we analyze, for example, the information of the oscillators about the final behavior of the agent, and we find how at the middle of each trial, the agent has maximal information about the behavior, but then its internal configuration changes and the information is lost. But instead, if we analyze the information sent by the synapses and the behavior, we find that the synapses are slowly storing information about future behavior. And this is where the information of the preference of the agent are stored in the synapses, because they are going to control which arc is going to be the future behavior of the agent. But if instead of the situated agent, we analyze the passive decoupled agent, we find that the synapses are not storing information anymore. All the information about the future behavior of the agent is lost. And that here we see how the synapses in this case are no longer able to influence what is going to be the behavior of the agents, and this loop of close regulation is broken. And in order to keep the analysis, we have used some measures of informational complexity in order not only to see the behavior between pairs of individual variables, but to understand the behavior of groups of variables. So we have used this measure of TST complexity that tries to analyze the information that is served between different bipartitions of the system. And this measure is intended to measure the complexity of the system, to measure how a system can be at the same time integrated, the behavior of all the variables integrated, and at the same time each variable can display its own individual specific and differentiating dynamics. So a system with a very high value of TST complexity is a system that is very well integrated, and at the same time it's able to present a very diverse and differentiated behavior at its particular components. So analyzing the levels of complexity in the two systems, we find that the situated agent has a much higher value of TST complexity than the passive decoupled agent. And we find that even if the two agents are receiving the exact same input with the same level of entropy, and its internal variables are going to have a similar behavior individually, and they are going to have the same levels of entropy, the value of overall complexity is much higher for the situated agent, meaning that there is some coordination at different scales of groups of variables that is higher than in the passive decoupled agent. And this is interesting to analyze what's the nature of this interactive asymmetry. which in contrast with previous analysis or previous work, this interactive asymmetry doesn't just arise as a directional vector which states that I influence the environment more than the environment influences me, but it has to do with the coordination between different timescales of the system. And we see that this asymmetry is depicted in a circular interaction between system and environment. The environment is able to influence the system at fast timescales. The system is able to react to the details of the complexity of the signals from the environment, and at the same time, the system is able to act over the environment at a slow timescale. So the system is going to be able to act over the environment at a macroscopic timescale. We find that this is a very interesting definition of this type of asymmetry between a system and an environment, and allow us to understand what's the difference on this interaction, which is no longer neutral, but we can differentiate in an interaction which is the agential component, the component that has an agency, and the environment in which and the environment which is being acted upon. Finally, we have analyzed the long-range correlation of the one-over-f scaling of the system, which allow us to differentiate between different types of dynamics based on the relationship between the different timescales of the system. So we can capture this relationship by a coefficient, which shows us when the different scales of the system are over equilibrated and the system is behaving at different frequencies, which is typical of self-organized criticality and systems which are able to present, to behave at all different possible time scales. Whenever this coefficient goes to zero, we have a white noise in which we find no correlation. And when this coefficient goes to two, we have a Brownian noise, which presents a strong influence of slower time scales, and it's more difficult to present a fast adaptive behavior. We analyze again the long-range correlations of the system between the situated and the passively coupled agent. We find that the situated agent presents a value of beta which is close to one, suggesting that the agent is critically self-organizing at a point of continuous beta stability, whereas the value of the beta coefficient for the passively coupled agent is reduced, meaning that the different scales of coordination are reduced for this agent. So, to conclude this part, we can say that we have provided a mathematical characterization of properties that have been generally addressed as qualitative theoretical properties, like, for example, the system constitution through an operational closure, or the agent-environment interactive asymmetry in the causal relation by defining this circular interaction between system and environment, and the precariousness of the metastability of the system in long-range correlation. Now we can move to the second part of the dissertation, which addresses social autonomy. And first, we shall start with analyzing the importance and the role of the interactive domain in social engagement. And for analyzing this, we are going to analyze first a simple system of two agents interacting in a simple computer game. So here, the idea is that, as we said in the introduction, autonomous agents can interact with a non-autonomous environment, but they can also interact with other autonomous agents. And our question here is that if it is there an interaction domain that happens at a different level than the dynamics of individual agents, where a kind of a social autonomy or social agency can emerge. For analyzing this, we are going to analyze the perceptual person experiment, which is a minimal framework for analyzing social engagement in which we have two players with a computer monitor and a computer mouse, and they can move in a horizontal world, they can move their mouse horizontally, and whenever one agent crosses the mouse of another agent, they are going to feel a sound or a signal that is going to indicate this crossing. So they are going to be able to generate complex patterns of interaction in this one-dimensional world. So, our question here is, again, what's the importance of this interactive domain, or what role it's playing? how we can compare the situation when we have this interactive domain present, when this interactive domain is absent. So we are going to compare the behavior of genuine human versus human interaction with other situations in which a human is playing with a simple program bot. And the first bot is going to be an oscillatory bot with a very predictable behavior. And the second kind of bot is going to be a more complex bot, which we call a shadow bot, which presents a complex movement, which is going to be something as in the passive decoupled agent is going to be recorded from the behavior of the human. So the structure of the behavior is going to be like the behavior of a human player, but it's not going to be any coupling between the human and the bot, at least in the side of the bot. We tried different measures to analyze what was the behavior of different kinds of interactions, and we find that we could easily find the difference in aggregated probability density functions between many trials of the time between crossings, the probability density function of the how much time it takes to cross again. And we found that the difference between the different types of behavior was in the scaling of these density plots, density functions. So we thought that if we in an aggregated plot we could find this scale, these different scalings of different agents, it would be interesting to analyze the individual dynamics you're looking for long range correlation and which is the scaling of the dynamics of each individual trial. So we use one over the scaling analysis. We found that many of the functions presented whatever of scaling with different coefficients of beta, so we characterized these beta coefficients to understand what was the dynamics going on at different kinds of interaction. So our idea is first to find if there is one over of correlations at the behavior of the agents, and if there is any difference between the individual dynamics of the agents and the interactive dynamics, to understand if there is a difference between the individual domain of interaction to the social shared domain of interaction between the two agents. So first we analyzed the one over the scaling for individual dynamics for both the entire behavior and the opponent behavior. We analyzed the entire velocity and the opponent velocity. And we find that the entire velocity was very similar for all cases. It doesn't matter if you are interacting with a computer bot or another human, you are going to have a beta coefficient which is close to 1. And if we analyze the opponent velocity, we find that the human agent and the shadow agent, which is working for the first, they both present a value of beta which is almost close to 1. And the oscillator bot presents a value of beta which is much higher because it's an oscillatory behavior and it doesn't present this 1 over n behavior. But we cannot differentiate between the shadow bot and the human bot interaction. So instead of the individual dynamics, we measure the interactive dynamics when the human player was playing against an oscillator, a shadow bot, or another human. And we found first that when the human is playing another human, the value of beta is closer to 1 than in other cases. And in this case, we can differentiate between the different kinds of behaviors. The interaction with the oscillator drifts toward brown noise, and the interaction with the shadow drifts towards white noise. So each kind of interaction presents different dynamics, and this is what is the aggregated plot, but we can also see it in the dynamics of the individual trials, where we still have these different scalings, and in the case of the human versus human interaction, we see a clean one over f distribution, which is not present in the others. So to conclude this part, we see that we can identify fractal scaling in genuine human versus human engagement. When we have a human versus human engagement, we can find a 1 over dynamical distribution with a value of beta which is close to 1. And we can only find it in a shared interactive domain. Or it only is part of the specific of a genuine social engagement when it is looked in an interactive domain. We cannot characterize genuine social engagement when we analyze the individual domains of the agent. So this result suggests that the process of social engagement may have, at least in some cases, an autonomy of its own, and this autonomy shouldn't be reduced to the autonomy of the individuals. And in this this way, the sensorimotor interactive domain that we found and we analyzed in neurocognitive agents might be extended into a social interactive domain. Now we shall start with the last part, which addresses the constitution of collective autonomy in a social reality. So we are going to analyze a particular case of a collective system developing an autonomous behavior. So the question here is, first, if we can define a level of identity of collective agent, and second, we want to explore what mechanisms might be giving rise to this collective autonomy. For analyzing this, we choose a specific topic of analysis, which is rising some academic interest during the last years, which is that of network movements since 2011, like the Arab Springs or the Occupy movement or the 15M movement, which are movements that present a particular dynamic, because they are movements that they are not based in previous formal organizations, but yet they present strong aggregation dynamics that are able to conserve, in some sense, the autonomy and the diversity of their participants. And this has been labeled as a different kind of collective identity, called multitudinous identities, that tries to explain this coordination, this correlation between a level of strong aggregation and an internal level of multiplicity or autonomy of the components. So, what we want to analyze here, or what we want to explore, is how does a multitude that doesn't have a formal organization underlying it can organize to bring, for example, a democratic demand in this case, articulated through the through online space and occupied physical spaces like a square. These are images from the Tahrir Square in Egypt, from social media, from the occupation of a square, a campaign square. So we choose a specific case of analysis from this kind of movement, which is the 15M movement in Spain, which was a large grassroots movement from 6 to 8 million of participants at some point, which had an intensive use of social media communication tools. And for analyzing it, we have chosen a large data set of almost 1.5 million tweets from almost 200,000 users between May 13 and May 31. And analyzing this data set, we have performed different analyses in order to try to capture what are the mechanisms that are giving rise to this collective autonomy. So first, we analyzed the transfer entropy between different geographical locations of the system in order to analyze what's the operational closure of the system. So we took tweets arising from different cities and analyzed how the activity at each city, the bursts of activity at each city, influence other bursts of activity at different cities. And so we can map the network of relations, and we can see how at some particular moments the system arises as a system which is strongly connected, and it presents an operational closure, meaning that the system is not only the components of the system are not only following one particular node, but all the nodes of the system are influencing each other in a circular way. For understanding not only how this closure arises, but what mechanisms might be maintaining it, we can analyze the dynamics of the system. And we choose to look for the presence of synchronized activity at different time scales. For doing so, we use a wavelet phase locking analysis, which consists in filtering the activity of the system at different time scales with wavelets of different frequency. And for each time scale, look for links of synchronization which are statistically significant at different points. The number of links of synchronization, for example, we see here that the day where the camps of the protests started replicating in different cities, we find that at the moment in which they start, we find a strong moment of synchronization. And we choose to show here a particular example of how this synchronization works by the case of one day of particular relevance of very strong activity in social media, which is the day in which one of the biggest camps, which was the camp in Barcelona, was evicted by the police and again was regained by a mass massive peaceful demonstration, and after that many demonstrations at most of the main cities in Spain took place in solidarity with the violence in the eviction, and a huge movement was triggered this day from this theater in reaction to this eviction. So we wanted to understand what was the relation between the internal synchronization and the different states of the synchronization and the embodiment of the protest occupying the streets and so on. So we found that we have at least two levels of collective action. The first level was active mostly in the morning, which was related to Plaza Catalunya in Barcelona, which was the physical location of the camp that was evicted. And we find that we have different hashtags that are active mostly in the morning related to the Acampada Barcelona or the events that were happening in the eviction. And the second level of behavior is happens at a countrywide level of many cities that decided to organize rallies of protest against the eviction of Plaza Catalunya. And we were active mainly in the afternoon after the demonstrators were able to regain Plaza Catalunya. And the every city demonstrator decided to bring flowers in order to protest to the eviction. So we can took place on this event, and we can analyze the rise of how the Facebook coalitions of synchronous activity emerge at different moments. We can find this coalition in the morning, and we can find this set of different coalitions in the afternoon. And we can extract the activity at the main frequency of the synchronized coalition, and we decided to extract these two big coalitions of synchronized activity. And our question here is if we can confirm the existence of two moments of global response, and if whether the system is switching from one mode of engagement to other mode of engagement. So in order to analyze that, we use transfer entropy, but now we didn't measure the transfer entropy in the bars of activity, but we took the activity at one particular frequency, and we analyzed the transfer entropy between the different phases of the different components of the signal. You can imagine different cities that are synchronized, and the phase of these oscillatory signals can transfer information to one another. And so for the two coalitions, we measure the relation between different components, and we can draw something like this with the relation between the activity at each city. And we find that the first coalition, which was taking place when the square at Barcelona was being evicted, the main node that transfers the most information to all the others is the node of Barcelona. So all the network is synchronized, focusing in the node of Barcelona, and at some point a new coalition emerges which overlaps the other one during some hours, and then it's active, in which the node of Barcelona is no longer the focus of activity, the source of information, but information is scattered between other nodes that are organizing these solidarity demonstrations. And finally, the last analysis we made in this part is we want to look for the correlation between moments of embodiment, synchronization, operational closure, and internal complexity. So we can look for the moments, the different days, in which operational closure is reached the whole network, or synchronization is higher than the mean values of synchronization during that days. We want to compare it with the embodied activity of the system, and for doing so we took a database called GDEV database, which monitors news events and with different tags, and we extracted all the mentions to protest in Spain during that time. So we have a signal of how strongly embodied the system is in particular protest, and we find the day with most intense protest in Spain during that day. And we find that there is a correlation between different moments of synchronization and closure and disembodied activity, and we find that the operational closure and synchronization is preceding the arrival of moments of synchronization in both cases. So we can think that the autonomy of the social subject appears to be connected with the embodiment of this interactive domain that first was taking place only in synchronization of networks, and then it's embodied in the street or in the squares and so on. Finally, we can complete this analysis with again measures of informational complexity and one over F scaling,
And we find that these indicators of complexity are again correlated with all the indicators. So somehow we have this group of indicators that assess the operational closure or the synchronization or the embodiment of the system. They show us how the system is constituted at some particular moments of time. And on the other hand, we have these indicators of complexity indicating that when the system is strongly constituted, it is when the system has the highest internal complexity. So it indicates that the type of subject that is emerging here is based on this internal multiplicity and internal complexity. And also we see that these moments of constitution of complexity are not random moments, but they consider the first qualitative city process, or the moment of replication of camps in different cities, or the selection of placental cellular, considered with moments of particular relevance in the embodiment of the system. So we can conclude that social agency, at least in this case, in this type of movements, cannot be reduced to ideas of political representation or a fixed bureaucratic organization, and instead we have identified mechanisms of constitution of this social agency, like operational closure or tracing with this synchronization or this internal multiplicity, which portrays a very different kind of social identity, which we have labeled by this idea of multitudinous identity, to understand that it's a specific case of collective identity based in this internal multiplicity or this transient synchronization mechanisms at different time scales. And now we shall present some lines of discussion over the contributions. And we can say that first, that in the first part of the dissertation, we have contributed to the development of a modeling route for testing, comparing, and validating hypotheses about neurocognitive autonomy. And this modeling route can be helpful for generating proof of concept for some properties of cognitive autonomy, like the how operational closure emerges, or how what's the role of an agent environment interactive domain. And it also can generate new predictions about the nature of autonomy, like multi-scale symmetric rating we were seeing, in which the agent has this circular relation with the world, or the double metastable regulatory loop, or the coordination of spatial and temporal multi-scale complexity. For the second part, we have explored the extension of our model of cognitive autonomy to the social realm. We have analyzed the constitution of a collective subject in the sensory domain in a social interactive task. We have analyzed the emergence of an autonomous social identity in a large-scale technologically-mediated social system, and we see that the similarities between social and neurocognitive autonomy, like the transient coalitions of embodied action or coordination of spatial and temporal multi-scale complexity, can provide new conceptual and analytical tools for thinking about social and political autonomy. In a more methodological domain, we have identified how indicators of complexity, like informational complexity or metastable synchronization or critical scaling, can act as proxies for quantitative and qualitative aspects of autonomy. These indicators are not per se sufficient for detecting if a system displays an autonomous organization, yet they can enrich the qualitative intuitions indicating so. Moreover, furthermore, we see that conceptual aspects about how we apply these indicators, for example, for depicting the operational closure of a network, or for comparing between situated and passively coupled systems, provide a rich perspective for testing specific properties of an autonomous system. From this work, we see that we have two possible lines of future development. One would be the experimental validation of the results of models of neurocognitive autonomy. We have analyzed two different models, but we could extend this analysis to real cases of neurocognitive autonomy of subjects embodied in some particular task. The second line of development would be a further theoretical and experimental support of the similarities and specificities of social autonomy respect to models of neurocognitive autonomy, and understand better and have more evidence about how they might be similar, the autonomy in social and neurocognitive domain, and especially what particularities of the social domain cannot be captured by autonomy in the neurocognitive domain. So, to conclude, we find that, as we introduced at the beginning, autonomy can appear as a conceptual tool to break the neutrality of systemic perspectives. It can be a tool for distinguishing between the actions of an agent, which is asserting its identity and modulating its interaction with an environment, with respect to other situations in which maybe a system or an agent is just being dominated by exogenous or some harmful or prejudicial endogenous dynamics. So we have a framework that allows us to distinguish between dynamics of self-determination versus dynamics of subjugation. And the notion of autonomy, that we, autonomous agency that we have presented here, proposes a framework that allows us to quantify, to model, and to analyze the way in which interactions themselves allow living entities to emerge as self-referential, as self-modifying, and self-sustaining dynamical process which enact their own world. And we modestly hope to have contributed to the development of this notion of autonomy and its explanatory potential, which may help us in this endeavor. So, many thanks for your attention. I will end the presentation here.
Thank you, Miguel, for your presentation. And the first thing that comes to mind is how rich and full your dissertation is in terms of topics, of ideas, and methods. And in that sense, I really like to congratulate you in the sense of bringing together all kinds of interesting tools for analysis and applying them to questions that are not easy. You know, questions that are quite complex, that we often have to just be happy to discuss such questions or such notions as autonomy or interactions at a purely verbal or conceptual level, and how important it is to just bring this into operational descriptions that allow us to do experiments and so on. So that I quite enjoy that overall aspect of the whole thesis, as well as the whole wide range of topics that somehow end up falling within the idea of autonomy and the ideas that you investigate. So I would have lots and lots of small questions and clarifications, but I think to try to maybe focus on a comment that addresses more than just one of the models, and just one thing I noticed, especially when you compare the models that have to do with neurocognitive autonomy and agency with the social models, the interactive one and then the collective. One thing you notice is that at some points in the thesis, the ideas of autonomy and the idea of agency seem to slide into one another. At the neurocognitive level, there seems to be a clear idea when you say, well, we have an autonomous agent, and it is autonomous because of this reason, and it is an agent as well because of this reason. And one can conceive of identities that are not agents, something like a cell that is not interacting with the world, or even, and this is driving to my question, when you look at the social interaction case in the perceptual crossing experiment, that you show how the interactive dynamics seem to have a certain autonomy of its own. It's not the same to say that that concludes the question of whether that identity is also an agent. In the case of a social interaction, it seems like a question that is not that interesting, because we may have an ongoing social interaction, and that in a way, whenever we ask a question whether our interaction is also doing something in the world. But if you translate that this worry into the last part of the thesis, when you say you get collective identities or multitudinous identities, the question, and actually politically interesting question, is are they also social actors? Are they also agents, in a sense? And there is something what you say that might give us some clues that it may be the case, because all these correlations with the embodied parts of it. But still, how would you go about trying to go deeper and prove that when they get together and they get into this whole correlation, they also become social actors? Because social actors, you know, remember the requirements for agency, you've got normativity, asymmetry, and so on. So what are the norms? What are the things that they're achieving? What is the history that they're going of interactions with their environment? So maybe I wanted you to comment on these issues a little bit too. Okay.
Yeah, that's a really interesting discussion. And yeah, it's true that the two parts of the dissertation addresses the first part, probably addresses this issue much more precisely than the second part. And our idea here is that we have definitions of autonomous constitution, for example, of a cell. But this is a different, it does not necessarily imply that this level of agency is extended to, for example, a sensorimotor domain in which the system is coupled to the environment, but there is coupling. And in the first case, we can have identified how this this robot, this robotic agent, is interacting with the world and present some. We can characterize how the asymmetry is happening, and even if we deepen the analysis, we could analyze which norms are arising that guide the behavior and so on. And already with the contribution of this thesis, especially in the first part, was not only to say, okay, we have autonomous agents, we have a different kind of autonomy that basic autonomy of the constitution of an agent, which may take place at different levels, but to think about what tools may allow us to characterize not only autonomy, but this sensory motor or this interactive autonomous agency. And yes, the second part of the thesis in that sense is more exploratory of these levels of autonomy, of interactive social engagement, or this interactive constitution of a social subject. And it would be interesting to get further the analysis of these identities. And for example, in the case of a collective identity, it's not easy to understand the relation between this internal organization and embodied activity. In this case, the signal we had was very scarce, the number of demonstrations each day. But we potentially have the tools for understanding if the relation between this collective movement and its embodiment is that of an agent, or even in the case of a cell, we could have the tools to analyze if a cellular autonomy is interacting with the world as an agent or not. Mm-hmm. So yes, probably the dissertation doesn't completely ask the question of whether a collective agent of this kind, this kind of multitudinal social organization, is an agent. We provide some clues of how what's the relation between the internal organization and multiplicity and embodiment. But yes, of course, it will be interesting to apply this analysis we performed the first part to richer cases of the of collective embodiment, in which we can analyze these relations and analyze if they are asymmetric.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so is it with Seth Bullock now?
Thank you. So I think my first comment, thank you for the presentation. I thought that was an extremely interesting account of the thesis, which was very broad, very deep. There's a lot of material there, and I think you did an extremely good job of being able to present it in a coherent way that I think people can understand. And in general, I think the what impressed me as I was reading the thesis was the combination of, there's a lot of historical treatment of the concepts that are at the root of the problems that you're dealing with, but there's also this ambition to take on very many different methodologies. So, whereas many theses that I've seen would have taken one of those tools, dynamical systems analysis, or networks analysis, or information theoretic measures, the ambition to combine those in parallel with each other is very exciting. The question or the issue that I would like to talk a little bit with you about concerns, there's a sort of tension in this, in work in this area, between the notion, on the one hand, we're told that to be autonomous, a system has to exhibit this kind of interactional asymmetry. So the system with the autonomy has to have the upper hand over the environment in terms of some ability to modulate the way that it's coupled with the environment. But on the other hand, in your thesis, we're told that the autonomy of a cognitive system is not located within the agent itself, but is somehow shared with the environment in the form of this kind of sensorimotor coupling. And you use an interesting device to help kind of resolve this tension, this notion of a dynamic core. So that idea comes out of neuroscience, where it's used to describe things that are wholly inside the head of an agent, right? Some neural dynamics that are going on, and they are the dynamic core that is somehow responsible for the behavior. But what you want to do is take that dynamic core and bring elements of the environment into it, and yet maintain this asymmetry. So on the one hand, with one hand, you bring the environment into the core, and you say the environment can be a kind of first-class participant in the autonomy of the agent. But with the other hand, you say no, the environment has to remain a second-class participant, because it must be dominated by the agent. The agent can't be subjugated by the environment. So I guess I just wanted to hear a little bit more about how you see that tension, and whether the environment can really be a part of this dynamic core.
Okay. Yeah, right, yes. This is one of the main themes I want to explore, how to resolve. And yeah, we propose that this interaction of terrain and environment is constitutive of the kind of autonomous agency that arrives. And how I see it, I think that this tension between being coupled with an environment and maybe not being able to distinguish what is environment, what is agent, what is an autonomous entity, and being separated from the environment, unable to stand out or to establish an asymmetrical relation with the environment, should be found in the different scales of description of the system. And as I said, I think that if we define these different levels, and for example, at one level we can have the system and the environment as material different entities, but we can have a higher level material, higher level relational levels of description, and precisely the idea of a dynamic core, which as it is normally defined in terms of, for example, PhD complexity or other indicators of complexity, what tries to depict is the relation between these low levels of description and these high levels of description of systems that can be integrated but can have their own differentiated dynamics at the low level. And what I think is that the emergence of these higher level patterns that are relational, at the end they comprise the relations between the different neurons, but also the relations between the environment. These are the ones that can modulate the interactions at the lower level. So that you cannot have both, you cannot have the system and the environment and the two connected, instead that these things happen at different scales. So at one scale, we can see that how the interaction between the system and environments is very directional. At the other scale, maybe this direction is reversed, or this is modulating how different kinds of behavior takes place. So I will say that the agent is modulating its relation with the environment in a symmetrical way, but if you are truly in a sensorimotor interaction, the higher order patterns that modulate this copying are going to be relational. I think that in this way is how this tension may be solved.
Can I quickly follow up? So you use this nice example in the thesis of a woman who is going to work, she's a cyclist, and she can sometimes take a quick journey, but it's on a busy road, or she can take the slightly slower journey, but it's through a park and it's nicer. And some days she chooses one, and some days she chooses the other, and she is exercising some autonomy in that choice, but the environment has some role to play. Today the traffic is very busy, or today the weather is terrible. So one might imagine that over the course of a year, there is a very long scale sort of dynamic that is in the environment. The weather gets colder gradually, it gets rainier, and she starts to pick the quick route more often. In your simulations, though, the environment doesn't have any of these long timescale intrinsic dynamics. The colored lights appear at random for the duration of the trial, and then next time they appear at random somewhere else. So the longest timescale dynamics in the simulation belong to the agent, because it's the only thing that really lasts in the world. If you change your simulations to include long-term unfolding intrinsic environmental dynamics, do you think that you would find another arrow in your cycle, a slow modulation from the environment into the agent? And would you be happy with that, or would that mean, is that subjugation of the agent by the environment, or is that just multiple scales of asymmetry?
Okay, yeah, following the example, I think, yeah, in this case, you have the cyclist, and you have the environment, and you learn this distinction of the agent who chooses to the route to take every day. But there is this other level of accumulated relational processes of how I go use this path, and this happens, and there's weather conditions, and you have this higher level of relations between agent and environment that is able to modulate the agent environment interaction. In the same way, what I think in the agent is of course much more simple, and the environment is it only changes in the position of the lights, but the long scale dynamics that happens take place in the behavioral preferences of the agent. The agent will go to one light for 10 trials, then go to the other for 20 trials, and this is not only happening inside the agent, it happens because particular positions of the lights that doesn't disrupt the internal configuration, so it's a relational level in that sense. And I think that that what is interesting is that the modulation of the agent, which in this case we analyze it, we identify in the relation between the synapses of the agent, which store all this information about how I went to that light and then I choose the other, and like all this history of interactions, this model is coming between all this history of interactions in the captured by the synapses and the environment in this circle there. And in that sense, I think that there's this relational domain of modulation is found there. And for the question of if we had a lower scale level of regulation of this environment, I will say that it imposes a relation of subjugation or not, depending on how much it is able to, if, for example, if the agent will choose light, to change the light automatically every time for example, the season changes and it's winter, and if then it will be clearly a variation of situation. But if the agent is influenced by this scale, but it's somehow able to maintain its preference depending on the particular history of previous regression, for example, I have choose this light disorder and then the season changes, but I will keep going a little more and saying after some trials depending on what I find, then this we could analyze with this kind of information measures whether the agent is being subjugated by this longer time scale or if it is just using them for modulating its own behavior or what, or to what extent we can, it's not, maybe it's not black or white, we can have some points in the middle and measure what's the influence of the agent and the environment.
Making the questions like the other people have made all the questions. All right, anyway, I have all the questions. So there are several things that I like from the thesis. One that I really appreciate is that usually people does not have a really good historical timeline of what happened in the past. In a way, builds our knowledge today. Yeah, it's very nice to see that you built a lot of ideas, very well organized about cybernetics and all the old story. But for the same reason, I also find some gaps, and I'd like to know why is that. Some of them are very specific, some of them are more broad. For example, one of the main things that you consider clearly is interaction between an agent and the environment, and to what extent the behavioral traits of the agent, as you observe from the outside, are changed because you are interacting with some context. I have more questions about that, but one thing that I think was a very important contribution at the time was Greywater, which you actually mentioned one of his books. On brain waves, but he has the other book, which is I think it's the other book, Thinking by Machines, which is a book about his little turtles that go around as agents, and there actually is a lot of discussion about why when you put the agent in the context of even a trivial thing like the home. Sometimes unexpected behaviors come out. And I think that there was a very interesting previous episode of that. You didn't mention that for any particular reason? Or?
Obviously I haven't read some papers from Greenwater, but I have not read that book. I choose to explore more on the question of the work of Ezequiel because I was interested in mechanisms that explicitly address this modulation of its own configuration. And because, I were thinking of how to model this kind of mechanisms, and that was the region because most of the space is given to the idea of trustability and so on. But yes, maybe that would be a nice contribution to the historical part of it.
Yeah, I think it's quite fits quite well as a precondition to that. And more generally, it could be argued that in a way people working on what you could call artificial ethology are also playing around these kind of problems. Once you put your cognitive agent in a context, then the behavioral traits that you can identify and the description you might make of the internal dynamics may be short in terms of having a picture of what happens in the environment.
So what do you say is your contribution that makes makes it different or you know more relevant in any way than other work in the area?
So
to rephrase what I'm saying is in a fundamental way there's a lot of work on how robots, for example, behave in a given environment, how they manage to as embodied objects, how they manage to gather information and behave. You have made an interesting thing, I think, which is use a very elegant model, the HKE model, which is mathematically well known, has very well defined symmetric properties, etc. And made the formal extension. I found it quite interesting. Do you think it's something more than that in your contribution?
Of that particular chapter. Okay. Yeah, this chapter, yeah, there's models that capture this idea of that is the behavior is different when you're embodied or not. Or the objective with this chapter was to have a picture of how different, we have a brief story about analyzing how these ideas of embodiment have been applied or not in mainstream neuroscience. And then the intent of the chapter was maybe not proving something new, but to have a simple model that we can easily analyze. It's just three dimensions, and we can extract the phase space and the attractors, and like so. It's in that sense, it's more. I think the contribution is more like having a very simple model in which we can precisely analyze these changes in the phase space and the difference when it's passively coupled and so on. So that, but yeah, probably there is many more models that have analyzed this difference between or this influence of the model.
Okay. There's several places you use self-organized criticality in a way as you made a mapping. I don't know if you want to, but it's kind of a mapping of the presence of some scaling laws like logarithmic noise and the assumption that you have self-organized criticality, which is, you know, for many people is something that you actually cannot do, including myself, of course. You can have intermittent behaviors, some kind of particular forms of noise that leads to scaling laws, not necessarily self-organized criticality. It's important to make the point. And I'm also curious about another thing. In your dissertation, you mentioned the kind of levels of agency. Explicitly talk about having sensorimotor properties or metabolic agency or social agency, etc. That to me connects very strongly with something that might be missing here, which is the evolutionary part of the story. Within evolutionary theory, we have this idea of innovation as presented in this idea of major transitions. Major transitions, to a very large extent, imply that you jump into different levels of agency, usually, or maybe always, that typically needs some new class of embodiment. Maybe they go into a membrane, they encapsulate the code, or you go into a multicellular system that in a way requires the interaction between different simpler agents. You don't use that, you don't use or mention that, which makes your approach more, one would say, more like dynamics engineering class philosophy part, if you want.
Yeah.
Is there a reason for that?
Okay, so as to the first commentary about whatever noise and supposed difficulty, I agree that you cannot just assume that you have a self-organized criticality from whatever patterns. And we have a paper which is related to the work of chapter 4, which is depends a little bit more in how we talk about self-organized
analyze how different measures of scaling, like fractal and spectral patterns or fractal analysis, and more than that, we tested how the one-over-f patterns were maintained under different disruptions of the sensorimotor loop or the plastic mechanisms, and how perturbing changes in the parameters of the systems are changed with this idea of that the self-organized feature critical as a shock system is a system that is able to generate these scale-free patterns without a specific coupling of the parameters of the system. We try to change the parameters and to see that the scaling laws were maintained. So in that sense, I think we talk more of self-organized criticality for this unit. We tested to more extent the robustness of these scaling laws, and I think in general we try not to assume that much self-organized criticality for other chapters.
So regarding the second question, I was talking before of the first chapter where we analyze this agent, which is just gets to an environment, and we then analyze the agent, which is able to modulate its own coupling with these plastic mechanisms and so on. And yes, I think it would be interesting to connect this idea of to analyze in more depth the transition from an agent which is just able to be embodied in a world to an agent which has these plastic mechanisms that we identify as modeling some form of agency of regulating the loop. And it could be interesting to connect to this other type of work or developmental or evolutionary patterns. Probably it would be interesting even to apply artificial evolution to an agent and look in different stages the behavior of the agent and see at which point, for example, this asymmetry between agent and environment emerges, and see if it's an abrupt transition or if it's more happens in stages or what's the case here. Yeah, I think that would be a very interesting development of the work that happens in the field.
Okay. Well, that is actually ongoing work in that area. And I think it's important for several reasons. One is that if you look at agency as forms in which you, as part of the adaptation, you become more independent on the environment fluctuations, then it's I think it's an important lesson to extract. And I think it's important also because if you get more independent on the environment, in a way, if you just simply ready to react to whatever is statistically probable, then it might be the case that the environment is more like a statistical background from which you can actually place more relevance into how the agent reacts into that background. Because you emphasize a lot about in several places that we might be missing something really relevant about the agent features by ignoring the environment. But it could be argued that maybe the environment in a way is something you can collapse into some kind of statistical background. Yeah, I'm just thinking out loud, but I'm not expecting a question, an answer for that. One thing I will say just as a comment is that there's been in the last year's kind of a renewed interest in maybe not self-organized criticality, because it's conceptually is a kind of a specific kind of way of generating avalanches, etc. But in systems poised to criticality, and in that sense, I will mention you don't mention that and you didn't use that, but William Bialik and others have been using kind of a new formal approach. It's not new really, but they use the pairwise correlation between states in the system, and in a way to show that the system, beyond scaling laws and other things, has a potential capacity to really react to any kind of external signal, which is a feature you have in critical points. It's a very neat formalism. It's easy to apply, and it's been applied to many different systems, just to mention. And about the social part of the story, on the one hand, and I am sympathetic, when the 15M happened in
entire lab, we all went there when we heard that the police was coming. And so we could see what happened and how much the politicians lie about everything. On the other hand, that's it. It's a really tricky thing to talk about, and you know, autonomy in that context, because the boundaries here are much more difficult to delimitate. Here again, I would have expected, mention some of the work that's been done by people like Dirk Helving and others, try to see if they can build a physics of social crowds. And they have been quite successful at least in some context. The 15M is a tricky thing, because on the one hand happens in a situation where probably several historical processes collapse. You have all the media that allow, you know, to gather people in a very coherent way, in a very quick response time. Is a mixture of things happening. When you look at the networks that you have shown, you wonder, you give a good description of I think it's a good put set of measures to characterize the what happens, well, what kind of statistical things happen in the system. But of course it remains open if the fluctuations that you observe are a mixture of the spread of rumors and information in social networks, which we know if you reach percolation, they can be very, very rapid, plus memory effects and decay effects. So maybe for me the only missing thing, and it's not a criticism, because it's a really difficult thing, would be more like, is it possible to make a minimal model of that beyond the measurements that you did? I think that the good part of your analysis is that it provides a very good context to think about if it's possible to make a model of that. So it's been interesting for me. I just wanted to say that it's easy to make a criticism, of course, that everything but it's a very interesting case study. And I just wanted to mention another, I think, a relevant group of references that maybe it's not just you, so many people usually doesn't take much into account. It was in the late 80s and early 90s when Huberman and others developed this concept of computational ecology with agents participating in economical, social interactions and all the potential for emergent behavior of that. And I think that maybe the kind of problem you have been addressing can be explored using the tools that they use in their studies. And so I have many other questions that are not so relevant. But just say that I've been making some criticisms of particular things, but you have been very ambitious, and that's what I think is really relevant. That many theses that you can find out, the work has also been done very well, but there's no ambition beyond answering some simple questions. So you've been trying to really go very far. It's difficult to succeed when you try that. But I enjoy reading the thesis, and I think that it's plenty of items to think about, and I hope that you others keep developing those ideas, and I think that's all. You guys have any other question?
I wouldn't mind following up something that you said. I also was interested in the lack of an evolutionary dimension to the work, but that is maybe reflects the approach of some of the people that you're building on. There's a sort of central experiment that you use as a inspiration for a lot of your studies, where you have a little robot, but you decouple it from the environment and drive it with input from a different robot. So the experiment was done on kittens, and it's in a developmental context. And you, at one point in the thesis, you say, obviously, when I, the robot experiments that I'm doing don't have a developmental dimension, because the little robot that is being passively coupled, it's the first time that, that it's ever encountered that situation, and it doesn't get a chance to learn to cope with it. It just has to be it's subjected to this stream of input, and it tries to act, but nothing it does makes a difference to the stream of input. And you might imagine that the response, that the recordings that you take from that robot are going to be pathological. You know, it's in a pathological situation. So is there a variant of the experiment with the robots where you could bring back in, where you could make it a more fair comparison, where that the ability of the coupled robot to organize itself in some way so that the behavior that it exhibits is less, it could be less vulnerable to a kind of attack on the basis that you're just getting pathological behavior out of that robot.
So yeah, I think you could think or more intermediate position, but well, first I think that we tried some situations in which the agent was decoupled from the environment or was receiving just noise, and the passively coupled agent was the closest we could obtain to the original agent, because the signal is exactly the same and it's
but its initial conditions are different, is that right?
Yeah, the initial conditions are different.
So it starts in a different initial condition in terms of its internal state, and then it receives a stream of inputs. So after the first input, because its initial condition is different, it's not trained with that set of inputs, and it veers off or whatever. It can't make use of them really, because it's not in the right coupling. So then there are experiments where you impose some noise. And I think in those situations, do you start from the same initial conditions, or do you still have two random initial conditions for the embedded and the decoupled robot?
Yeah. In that case, since you have noise and the noise is different from, in that case, the noise, there's just one source of noise and the initial conditions are different.
So the initial conditions are still different?
Yes. I think I could imagine that test with more precision this, maybe it would be to see how very small changes in some conditions maybe change the behavior or not, or if there is a smaller distance between the initial condition of the two, to test if there is difference between the two. But yes.
What would happen if your little robot was allowed to do this repeatedly? It's decoupled, but it encounters 100 decoupled exposures, so that the homeostatic ability of the robot would that gradually, potentially it has the ability to organize itself in a way that copes better with the new decoupled state that it's in, which is presumably what's happening to the kittens in the real experiment. Right?
I think we made sure that the time of the simulation was much longer than the velocity of the synaptic mechanisms, and therefore I think the agent, after some attempts of trials, it's probably totally adapted to the pathological condition. And I think that to analyze something maybe more similar to the case of the development in the kittens, you will need to add maybe more other temporal scales of plasticity, maybe. Because then here, the plasticity, have different scales of plasticity, but they are constrained maybe to tens of trials. They cannot reach longer time scales, and we would have a exponential distribution of time scales of plasticity. Maybe there we can find more interesting distinctions.
And related to the more directly to evolution, so this issue of asymmetry, that the agents have to be different from the environment. Well, that's one, the, the abiotic environment is not the product of evolution in the same way as the cognitive agent. But you don't really take advantage of that in your story, right? But, and in many of the accounts that are derived from, you know, treatments of autopoiesis or what has come after that, they don't seem to really want to take advantage of that evolutionary story to separate the autonomous world from the non-autonomous world. So why do you think that's a strategic choice, or I think at some point there is a sort of political story about why the notion of autopoiesis should not be carried over to look at social organizations, and I wonder whether there's also a kind of, maybe with a small p, political reason why you would want to bring evolution into your story about where your autonomy comes from.
Okay, yeah, I think that probably the main reason is that say to maybe just to reduce the complexity in the analysis of these models, we took a lot, I believe the robot has just three oscillators and the plasticity, it was quite complex to understand what was going on there with the nine-dimensional physics space, and I think that having a new vector of evolution there will increase greatly the complexity of how different forms of regulation and comparing different stages in evolution. I think it will be much richer, but also I think that
I guess what I'm getting at, so let's go back to that example of a woman cycling to work.
Yeah.
So let's imagine that she does every day, the decision that she makes is determined by the environment. You do the analysis and you find out, well, I thought she was actually making a decision, but it turns out once I understand the kind of the relevant environmental factors, those entirely determine what's going on. But from an evolutionary perspective, that's exactly the right thing to do. That's how she survives and ends up having children. So the asymmetry, just the brute statistical information theoretic asymmetry, is the wrong direction. The environment is in charge, but it's still the case that the evolutionary asymmetry is in the right direction. The weather has not evolved to defeat the woman's journey into work. It's just a fact of life about the environment. The woman's strategy is what has evolved to take advantage of, and maybe even if it's very closely correlated with it, that's a good thing. That's not a sign of being subjugated by the environment. It's a sign of being, you know, fully aligned, fully mastering the variation.
Okay, yeah, that's very interesting. I think that, for example, here you're seeing genetic algorithms for the same day. We found that it was very hard and seeking logic because we had tried to use cellular simulations to find an agent that doesn't just stuck to some fixed bone or a tractor and stays there. And I think that maybe it's interesting to think that we as an autonomous agents evolve to our, because we need that agency in a particular type of environment. So I think that part of the complexity of taking into account an evolutionary perspective is in a modeling approach, is to maybe realistically simulate those environments, and it's maybe not easy to have environments that capture these requirements to act as an autonomous agent, and it would be a very interesting analysis to see what kind of environments we require to evolve autonomous behavior or this asymmetry between agent and environment. Again, this increases enormously the complexity of the research, but yeah, I think it's a very interesting route of development of this kind of analysis. It would be very interesting to test, for example, in this same simulation, what happens if you change the environment, or what happens if you have this long
once again, I think that it's interesting material to think about. He was making his question, also thinking about how do, for example, uncolonies fit into this kind of binary. You can see them as very simple agents. They are dependent on the one hand to individual detection of environmental clues, but then collectively they can suppress the environment by using a pheromone field that amplifies some particular signals and then can get rid and ignore the rest of the environment. So again, I'm thinking out loud. I think it's interesting to think what other things can you put in this diagram, and this diagram maybe has to be broadened in some way. But anyway, you see, it's totally making you think about other ways of exploring ideas. Okay, so is anyone in the room who wants to say something and has a PhD? That's two conditions. No one? Okay. So now we will go to our deliberation. So if anyone can move outside.
No.
So after delivering and after the presentation, all the members of the committee agreed that this is an outstanding thesis, and we gave you the highest score, sobresaliente. As you know, the cum laude is decided privately by every member, but you have the outstanding qualification. Congratulations.
Well, it's been fascinating to be the supervisor of Miguel. I think we all the supervisors share that experience of a student that started doing his work and he took off faster than we could follow him, actually. And in my case, it was a very fantastic experience. The first time we met, because he already read my thesis, and that triggered a lot of ideas that are now reflected in this one. And I hope this chain continues and somebody takes and reads his thesis right after he or she finishes the degree, and that triggers a new PhD thesis, and they can this way be linked. Because there's something about PhD thesis is that you don't very often find in books which have a more systematic and raw writing of the ideas, and sometimes they are kind of a textbook of methods in this case, and ideas that are being born, and I think it's I'm very proud of the process, and also very proud that people like you could come and found the thesis appealing and exciting. I think it was thank you very much all of you, and especially Miguel, because he's been a superb student and colleague, because we've been working in the last papers. We were, I don't know, truly colleagues on doing research, and I hope this relationship lasts for forever. I don't know, that's my
Yeah, it's going to be very difficult to find another doctoral student as Miguel.
Yeah.
He combines creativity, mathematical skills, computer skills, so I just can say congratulations and thanks for coming and doing the PhD with us.